Welcome to Love Fellowship Believers. I'm Pastor Kevin Webb. We're on the beautiful campus of North Carolina A&T State University. We're located in the Alumni Event Center. We have our intercessory prayer at 9:30, our Sunday school at 9:45, and our worship service at 11 o'clock. We'd love to have you to come out and worship with us. Please join us already in service.
We're going to get ready for our next speaker. And up next, we're going to have Evangelist Danielle White. Amen. Minister White was born and raised in Asheville, North Carolina, by her beloved grandmother, Anna Robinson Edgerton. Danielle grew up in St. Luke AME Zion Church. As a youth, she sang on the choir and was a part of the Sunday school ministry. She gave her life to the Lord at a very young age and rededicated herself back to Christ at 19 years old. It was then that Danielle began to take an even closer walk. Danielle joined Johnson Memorial College. Thank you. It's okay. In 1994, and received the baptism of the Holy Ghost not too long afterwards. She served in a high capacity to the church under the tutelage of her pastor, Elder Theodore, and missionary Beverly Wells Smith, and many others who helped rear her spiritually. Whatever her hands could find to do, she did it. Now that tells you something about that awesome lady of God. A list of her responsibilities were serving as women's ministry leader, choir member, drama ministry, praise team member, youth Sunday school teacher, Tuesday night Bible study teacher, prayer ministry leader, and Wednesday noonday service speaker. Now that tells you she does not mind working for the Lord. She does not mind. Even while living in Raleigh, North Carolina, Danielle still managed to be a part of the ministry of her church. She was a faithful member up until the passing of her beloved pastor, Elder Theodore Lamont Smith. Since that time, Danielle has been fellowshipping at different local churches until recently. She recently made Redemption World Outreach Ministries her new church home. Danielle is also the proud owner of Salon Rocher, located in Asheville, North Carolina, and is a veteran stylist who is celebrating 20 years this year. She is known in Asheville and surrounding areas for her healthy hair care practice. Her most important job besides serving the Lord is being a wife and a mother. She was married to Mr. Julian Spencer White Jr., and they are the proud parents of Christian Spencer White. Danielle is honored to be here and considers it a royal honor to share a word with you. Thank you to your pastor, Elder Maxwell, my brother in Christ, whom I've had the awesome privilege of being a co-laborer with at Johnson Memorial Garden of Prayer. And we are honored to have you here, Mr. White. We thank you. And we do know that God has prepared yet another awesome word, so get your pen and paper ready. Because when we go out here, we will be equipped. This is a book you're going to hang on to for life. Okay. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. And hallelujah.
He is so worthy to be praised.
Amen.
It's been said that it's a privilege to be here, really. And as Minister Tanika said earlier, she didn't say it in these terms, but people see your glory, but they don't really know your story. So it's a privilege to even be breathing. Amen. It's a privilege to be alive.
Amen.
And I just thank God for all that he's done. And I thank you for allowing me to stand before you all today. As I was preparing on today, Elder Maxwell, of course, gave us what we're supposed to. He gave us our topics and what we're supposed to speak on. And as Tanika said, it's kind of hard when somebody gives you a topic and you got to try to stick to that thing, but it is well. And your theme is cover me because I'm going in. And my topic is covered in my family. And we've already heard the scripture read from the book of Esther, but I'm going to reread that passage of scripture, because we are talking about being covered in our families. And we're going to go to Esther chapter 4, and I'm going to read. When Mordecai perceived all that was done, Mordecai rent his clothes and put on sackcloth with ashes, and went out into the midst of the city and cried with a loud and bitter cry, and came even before the king's gate, for none might enter into the king's gate clothed with sackcloth. And in every province, whithersoever the king's commandment and his decree came, there was a great mourning among the Jews, and fasting, and weeping, and wailing, and many lay in sackcloth and ashes. I'll stop there because it is a long scripture and we have heard it, but just to give you an overview, the Jews were about to be annihilated. Haman had issued a decree that all the Jews should be killed because he was a hater. He was jealous of Haman and Haman's walk and the anointing on Haman's life. And as I began to prepare to share this message with you, I have to reflect on my own life and some of the great triumphs God has given me through immense suffering and through immense pain. Before I can get into the word, I believe that God has given me to share with you. I believe I have instructions to share a little of my own Esther story. And let me just say, all of us are Esthers, because everybody has been through something at one time or another. No one is exempt from persecution, from trial, from tribulation. We all go through it at some point or another, but the difference is Jesus. And back in Old Testament time, they didn't even know who Jesus was. But we're living in New Testament time, so we know who Jesus is. So we're able to call on his name and place a demand, and he hears us. I grew up in a very loving household, yet it was volatile at times. I grew up as an abused child, and Bunny, this is probably your first time being able to hear me talk about it. The Lord has released me since the beginning of this year to be able to talk about some of the pain I endured as a child. I grew up with a single mother. My grandmother also wound up taking me and raising me. I grew up with two aunts who helped to rear me as well. My grandmother was a saved woman, but there's a difference in being saved and delivered. You can be saved all day long, but if you haven't been delivered from certain things, then certain behaviors continue to manifest. So I grew up wondering why my mom hated me. I always wondered why she was so harsh and emotionless when it came to my sister and I. I grew up wondering why she didn't seem to care whether we existed or not. I grew up wondering why my grandmother seemed to have an aught against me. Though she loved me and lavished me with affection, there was something there that I couldn't quite put my finger on as a child. And I also had another aunt who was in the same household that didn't like me either. But I had one aunt who I called my Mordecai. And at that time, I don't even think she realized who she was to me. My Aunt Pat had to take the daunting task of planting many, many good seeds in me and many deposits to help me to get to where I am today. My granny lavished me with wisdom, so I'm able to draw off some of the wisdom that she planted in me. And if I get a little emotional, it's because I haven't been able to share this in Asheville. But the Lord has released me from this point on to share my story, especially across the pulpit. I remember times where I would lay in the bed at night and cry myself to sleep as a little girl, just trying to figure it all out. You know, as kids, we don't realize that we affect our children through our behavior and our attitudes. So we have to be careful the seeds that we're planting in our kids, because one day they're going to grow up and they're going to be women too. And we want them to make smart decisions, the right decisions. And we have to give them the opportunity and the room to grow and to do that. But I would lay in the bed and I would cry myself to sleep from the verbal, the emotional, and the physical abuse that I had to do. And I remember just wishing it would all go away. And one night, my aunt took me to her room. We had a huge house. So there were many rooms in that house. But her room was the room that I cherished the most. But she came and got me because I think she heard me crying. And she sat me on the side of her bed. And she said, you know, irregardless as to what they say about you, you're going to be just fine. She put her arm around me, and I remember just weeping. And at the time, I couldn't have been any older than 8 years old. And she said, they think you're stupid. They tell you you're retarded. They tell you that you're slow. They tell you that you'll never amount to anything. They also tell you that you'll be the first one in the family to get pregnant out of wedlock. They'll tell you that you don't know what you're doing. And she looked at me and she said, but I tell you that you're smart, that you're beautiful, and that one day you're going to be the one who this entire family has to lean on. And I stand to tell you today, excuse me, that I've had to be that one. My aunt died at the age of 29, the same aunt, from kidney failure and a heart attack and cancer at 29. Looking back on that, it was the seeds that had been planted in her that took her life. She was very depressed. I didn't know it at the time. I didn't discover that until after she was dead and began to reflect back on some things and listening to a lot that she had told me. She died at the age of 29 and left three children. My grandmother had to take those children in addition to my sister and I. I had to help rear all three of those children because my aunt died when I was 17, my senior year of high school. And out of seven children, she was the second of my grandmother's children to pass away. So out of five children left, no one stepped up to help my grandmother raise these kids. So in high school, I had two jobs, and I worked to help raise those children. My grandmother wound up passing in, I think it was 2005, and I wound up having to take care of her too, even though I lived in Raleigh. My sister died 6 months later in a tragic accident, and Sister Bunny knows who she is. And I wound up having to take her daughter, had custody of her for 6 months. My mom is still alive, and she's doing well. And since my sister's death, there has been a change of heart in her. Still praying for her, but that just goes to show you that out of all the negative things that have been said, out of all the hurtful things that have been done, you can still rise above all of it. You don't have to make excuses for bad behavior because you've been mistreated. Because when you know better, you do better. And it's time out for excuses in the body of Christ. God has given us the tools that we need to walk in the calling that he's given us. Some of you are having to be Mordecai. Some of you are having to rear children that you didn't ask for, take care of parents that you didn't foresee having to take care of, taking care of nieces and nephews that you didn't foresee having to take care of. But greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. He's already put everything that you need in you. And guess what? You're covered. The theme is cover me because I'm going in. You're covered in your family. So no matter how daunting the task is, God has given you everything that you need. And the story of Esther is one of the most well-known stories of the Bible. And what's interesting that in this book of Esther, they make no mention of God. They make no mention of God and his provision and his protection. But you can see his invisible hand there all the time. And let's paint a picture how God sets you up. It is first seen in the selection of this Jewish virgin named Hadassah, which is Hebrew for Esther. Her Persian name is Esther. She became the queen of Persia. So in studying this, that let me know that her original name was not Esther. That came from King Xerxes. Hadassah was her name. Persia was also a pagan society. They did not believe in God. They did not worship God. They did not serve God, which leads me back to why Haman hated Mordecai so much, because they didn't believe in God, yet he saw Haman going before the throne of God in his face. And it angered him, because why? The devil doesn't like when we submit to God. The devil doesn't like it when we begin to praise God. He gets angry. So Haman comes up with a plan to destroy all the Jews. Esther was not exempt because she was the queen. And I believe this is why Mordecai gave her a reality check by saying, don't think you're exempt because you're in the king's house. Don't think you're all that because you're in the king's house. Remember where you came from. Sometimes we need to be reminded, because sometimes we forget. But as I began to think about this lesson and think about seeds, and that's all I kept hearing is seeds, seeds, seeds. All of us came from a what? Amen. Mordecai had to raise Esther, and Esther was a what? So we have the cast that God has set up here. We've got Mordecai, we've got Esther, we've got Haman, and we've got Xerxes. And if Esther was a seed, and Mordecai fertilized her, watered her, planted her in good ground, gave her sunshine. In other words, these things stand for encouragement, support, being covered by your sister and your brethren. And not only that, but in turn covering somebody else. This was Esther. She flourished where she was at. Esther didn't ask for her position. I don't even think Esther liked being the queen, but it was what it was for the time. But these seeds eventually grow and blossom into a plant, or they become stagnant and they start to wither up. There's a little bit of life left there, but not much. Or either it dies. Everything that the enemy has sent is designed to kill you. But God has given you a good support system, I believe, in this church, to cover each other so that you don't wither up and die. Even though you've got the rain, you've got the fertilizer and the nutrients, you've got the soil, you've got the sunshine, these things do not determine the identity of who you are. Yes, people have done these things for you. Yes, they have planted in you. Yes, they have planted you and helped you get rooted. But they only encourage your growth and provide necessary nutrients for you to become who you're supposed to be. So if you will, jot this down, because you're going to need to remember that. And the reason I say that is because sometimes when people do things for you or help you get to a certain place in your life, they want to throw it back up in your face. And that can be very painful, and it makes you want to cut them off. But they only encourage the growth. God has put them there for a reason and for a season. Everybody's not meant to be in your life forever. Some people have to fall off just like leaves on the plants. They need to be pruned back. Sometimes the Lord will move you from where you are in order to heal you up and get you better. And if plants are not transplanted or repotted, they do not grow, or either they die. So sometimes God has to move you. He has to transplant you. He has to heal you up so that you can become all that he has for you. There are a few key points that I would like to make, and you may want to jot these down as well. Number one is that God has a built-in reward system. If you are his seed and you've been planted in the soil and he's fertilizing you and he's watering you and he's nourishing you, you're going to grow. Because a seed has no other choice but to grow or do what? Die. And he's called that we might have life and have it more abundantly. It's not his will that we should perish or wither up and die. You don't have to die because of your circumstances. And since he has this built-in reward system, if you think about a seed and how it grows, a seed doesn't require much but that you drop it in the ground. God causes that thing to grow. So think about it. His built-in reward system, by being affiliated with God and knowing him and being in God, he's going to take care of you. He's going to cover you in your family. He is our king. And anything that we get to do for God is a privilege. So even the flowers growing, they raise up and they point towards the sunlight because it's a privilege to be able to be in the sunshine, the S-O-N, shine. And during the times that people thought it was a privilege to serve kings, I observed that Mordecai had a servant spirit. Because, you know, back during that time, they had to bow down before the kings or either they would be killed. Mordecai did not bow before the king, because he knew who God was, and he refused. And after reading this, I observed that he covered Esther in the absence of her mother and her father. And it looks like to me that Mordecai was all that Esther had in the family. She might have had some distant cousins or distant relatives, but you don't hear the word make mention of those. And that's what makes this so important, the cast, Mordecai, Esther, Haman, and Xerxes. Because these are three of the main people that are mentioned in this book. Mordecai was Esther's only relative that was close enough to her to plant in her. So think about that one for a second. We're going to go back to this seed because this is just a little side note. God says that you have a right to place a demand on any seed that you sow. So if I've sown a seed in you, then eventually I may come and request something of you that I may need you to do. So I have a right to place a demand on that seed. And when I say demand, I don't mean it in terms of disrespect, but I do have the right to come back and ask you, can you do me a favor? Can you walk with me? Can you cover me? You have a right that if you speak the word, that you get good results of the word that you're speaking. This is going back to raising children. And when you're speaking to your sisterin and your brethren in the church. I was driving to work last week, and the Lord said, your words are containers of power. Your words are just like seed. The Bible says that the tongue has the power of life or death in it. And then the Lord said, observe what you say and how you say it. And then observe how it affects the person that you're speaking to. Watch their expression. If they're frowning, you're saying something they don't agree with 9 times out of 10. or they're absorbing what you're saying, maybe that's true. But you have a right that if you speak the word to get the results of the word that you're speaking. You have the right to make a good decision and expect a harvest to come from that good decision. And young people, you're here today. It's not that many of you, but I encourage you to sow seeds of good decision. Because when you get older, you may not experience that thing coming back on you as a young person. But somewhere in your life, it will come back up. The law of reciprocity is real. And I have a saying that I always say that you may not pay what you owe, but you will reap what you sow. So make sure that you're sowing good seed. If you want a good harvest, sow good seed. And you also have the right that if you've invested in a relationship, that you expect there will be a good return on that relationship. The Bible talks about when a sower sows the word, they sow it where? Where's the word sown? There you go. The heart is our garden, which is why I drew this illustration. This is our garden. And so we have to make sure that if there are weeds in our garden, we're pulling them up and pulling them out so that we're not dealing with bitterness and resentment, because those things can choke the word and hinder your growth and hinder your walk, and it can even kill you. The soil for the seed, now get this, the soil for the seed is not the head of a man. The soil for the seed is not the head of a man, but the heart of a man. So when the word is planted, it's planted in our heart. Because if it just stays here, it won't last long. And a lot of times we come to church and we hear the word, but as soon as we get out the door, we forget the word. And that's why we have to plant it in our hearts, because our heart is our what? It's our garden. The only thing you've got to do is let the seed hit the soil. That's all you've got to do. God gives the increase. You don't have to dance on it. You don't have to shout on it. All you got to do is let it get in your heart. Because see, a lot of times we come to church, we hear the word, and we'll shout right there where it feels good. But it doesn't go any further. It does not go any further. I have seen so many churches become stagnant because they want to make you feel good word. They want a word that'll make you shout. They want to hear that on the organ to make them shout. But we've got to get past that. Why? Because we're living in the last days, y'all. I don't know if you guys are watching or even paying attention, but the Bible says that the earth groans in anticipation of the Lord's return. So if the earth is groaning, we should be groaning too. Because the Bible says that our spirits groan and makes utterance unto the Lord that we don't even know. The earth is in anticipation of his return. And so we've got to get beyond the surface. We've got to go deeper into the word in order to grow. Because it just staying here, we can't change anybody. We can't impact anybody if we don't let that word get in us. And I believe that Mordecai knew God and walked so close to God that he was able to minister and witness and cover Esther until she got to where she needed to be. He covered her so well that he was able to go back and make a demand on that seed that he had planted in her a long time ago. And this is what we've got to start doing. Our children are suffering. Our children are dying. Not too many children nowadays could come through the stuff that I went through and survive. Because I remember myself at the age of 14 taking a bottle of pills because of the bad seed that had been planted in me. I remember taking those pills, laying on the bed, crossing my arms and saying, okay, God, I'm ready to die. With an attitude, because I'm tired of living. It's not even worth it anymore. Mama doesn't want me. Daddy doesn't want me. Grandma doesn't want me. Aunt Betty doesn't want me. So what's the use? And then being picked on and bullied in school didn't make it any better. And when I woke up the next morning, waking up the next morning, I said, God, you must have a purpose for me still being here. Because I swallowed so many pills, I should have been knocked out. I mean, done. But I'm still here. And I thank God for my aunt, my Mordecai. Because she's the reason that I'm here. God covered me. So now I'm going in. And what I've started doing through my business, my salon, is reaching out to other young women who I see they're suffering. And I've been able to witness just a little bit about what I've gone through. And I've got one young lady I will never forget, came into the salon one day, and she had just gotten out of the hospital, but it was the mental hospital. And she was only 14, the exact same age I was. And she had come to get her hair done. And this young lady has gone through so much and withstood so much. But I look at her now, and God has raised her up. Went to the mental hospital, got out, came and sat in my chair. They had given her pills to take to keep her mind regulated. And I stopped what I was doing, and I said, listen, you shall live and not die. I said, God is not going to have you walking around out of your mind. Your mother was saved. She planted the word in you. There is no reason and no excuse why you should be saying that you're losing your mind at the age of 14. We prayed right there in the chair. And I sent her to get a book. And Bonnie, I don't know if you remember the book that we used to use at church. It's called Prayers That Availeth Much. There was a book that we used at church that we used to pray prayers out of during noonday prayer. And I always kept my book with me. And I was able to give her a copy of the prayer for being in your right mind. That young lady took that prayer and prayed it several times over herself. And I would call and check on her. How you doing, Keisha? You doing okay? I'm fine. I'm fine. And with each time I talked to her, I could tell that she was getting her strength. And she was a little girl that had to fend for herself. Her mother died when she was 9. Her dad was raising her, but he was a drug addict. Her brothers were in the house, but one was selling and one was also doing drugs. So the house was unkempt. Little girl had to clean up for herself and basically shut herself off in her room. She is now, I'm thinking about 28 years old, married with a family. She is now directing the choir at her church and teaching Bible study. She never once had to go back to the mental hospital. And I told her, I said, you're not going to have a breakdown, but God is going to give you a breakthrough. And I said, I refuse to let the enemy have your life. I'm covering you. And so now I can go back and draw back on that same seed. So see, if I need an encouraging word, I can go get one from her now. You know, and that's the idea. You know, as the young lady said earlier, iron sharpeneth iron. That's what we're here to do. We've got to start doing that, loving on each other. There are so many hurting women in the body of Christ, and some of them are suffering silently because abuse in marriages also exists, and that's something that the church does not deal with a lot of times. That's something that the church does not talk about. That's a place I can also speak to. I was an abused wife, battered wife, beat down, just hurt. My husband had several affairs. Ex, I have my Boaz. My ex-husband was abusive, but guess what? He worked in the church. And I kept it a secret for years. But now I had been warned not to marry him. Talking about seed being planted. I had been warned. But I was still a little girl trapped inside myself, longing so bad to be loved. And so, because I didn't have a father figure, I married this man. There were nights that I thought he would take my life. There were times that I wore so much makeup, I looked like a Maybelline monkey, trying to hide the scars. But the biggest scar I tried to hide was the one on my soul. I went to church every Sunday. I sang in the choir, and I shouted it out. But did that deliver me? No. Until I got the seed of the word inside of me, and I had a pastor and a first lady that were my Mordecai. They covered me until I came out. And unfortunately, my first lady passed away, so all I was left with was my pastor. He was a father figure to all of us. And we talk about him often because Elder Smith was such an awesome man, and his wife was too. But I can remember calling him crying one day and saying, "Pastor, I just can't do it anymore." And he said, "Pack your stuff up, find an apartment, and I will pay for it until you can get on your feet." He was covering me. And so I'm here today again. I'm still here because it did not injure me. I can remember times where when I was still in the relationship with my ex-husband, praying for a baby. And this is about to get raw, so you guys have to excuse me. God has taken me a totally different way. Have a whole book of notes, but I feel led to share this because somebody might need it. I would pray for a child because they had told me I couldn't have children for years. While in the relationship, my husband had several affairs again and brought home an STD. I was scheduled to speak at church on a Tuesday night service. The nurse calls me from the doctor's office, and she says, "Danielle." And then she just starts crying. I'm like, "Oh, my God, what is it? Do I have AIDS? What is it? You know, please tell me. Don't cry." And she said, "I know how bad you've been wanting to have a child. But the STD that you have, you've had it for a while. And it's so bad that it's killed your chances of being able to have a child." She said, "You had a 5% chance, but now you have none." So the enemy, Haman, was trying to kill my seed before it could even be born. I went on to church and I spoke that night. And when I got home, I lost my mind. Okay? Because you can push a person to a certain point, and it's not that you're not saved. It's not that you don't love God, but you can only take but so much. I think I went so crazy that he called my first lady and she had to come to the house because that's what it took to get me off him. But one of the devastating things about it was that the lady he got involved with was my neighbor. She lived upstairs. Not only was she my neighbor, but she was pregnant by him. The pain, the Haman. Do you see where I'm going? This is the kind of stuff, the kind of seeds that the devil sows to make you wither up and die. But God said that you shall live and not die. I'm a witness. It got so bad that when the young lady was pregnant, she had a boyfriend. She would come to church with him. our church and had never been to our church before. So she wound up delivering the baby. And I remember sitting in the choir stand. And she would literally hold the baby up in the middle of service. Now, the baby couldn't have been more than a month old. And she did this quite a few Sundays. And when Sister Smith got a hold of it, she cut the devil off. My first lady told the young lady, don't come back. Because if you do, I can't be responsible for what I do to you. And she told her, this is my daughter. I'm covering her. You will not destroy her. And so saying all this to say that it did not injure me. It will not injure you. You might get a bump. You might get a bruise along the way. Pick yourself up, dust yourself off, and start all over again. And so, speeding it up a little bit, wound up getting out of the relationship, getting a divorce. It was painful because I felt like a failure. Have you guys ever been in a situation where you wanted something to work so bad, even on a job? You either lose the job, you have to quit, or it ends. And you feel like a failure because you thought that you were going to complete this thing. Well, I had many days where I would wonder, what if I had just stayed in it? We would be married for 20 years, blah, blah, blah. And Lord had smacked that stuff down a long time ago. So nevertheless, my Boaz came 2 years after my divorce. And let me tell you something, young ladies. The men may not always come in the package that you think they should come in, because I'm one for tall, dark, and handsome, or tall, nice hair, and fun. They don't always come like that. My husband is my same height, and my granny used to tease us and be like, oh, gosh, both of y'all are short. Y'all gonna have short babies. My husband was someone I would not have chosen for myself, but it was the best decision I could have made. I have been so blessed, and let me tell you, I have baby Christian. He's 4. The Lord gave me my baby. And another side note, I had gone through several surgeries from several reproductive issues. First doctor I had, I was with him since I was 18, told me he removed one of my ovaries, and that, you know, the stuff just wasn't working. But God had my womb closed from the first marriage so that I didn't produce any more bad seed. Amen. I didn't want to produce a Haman because that's what I had. I thought I did, but God knew what was best. And so out of that, God has built my character. He's made me much stronger. It hurt, y'all. All the stuff that I'm talking about, it hurt. But I'm still here. And something else just hit my mind, and I'm just putting all my business out there, and I hope this helps somebody. But I found out when I was 15 that my mom tried to abort me. And it made sense that she didn't want me growing up. She tried to abort me, but it didn't work. I am a failed abortion standing before you today. I'm here. And when I think about all those things and how God orchestrated it and set it up, I look at myself as Queen Esther. You know, my husband tells me, oh, you're beautiful. You look nice today. You know, that same look that Xerxes gave Esther when she gave him that little sad glimpse. I get that from my husband all the time. And so if you just wait on God, you plant his word in your heart, and you really, really believe it, oh, my God, the revelation of how much God loves you it's just so beautiful. And I don't think a lot of times we understand how much he loves us in church. God loves you. Just like the young lady said, your DNA cannot be reproduced. That's how much he thought about you before you even got here. He loves you. He set you apart. And you may go through some painful things in your family. You may go through some painful things on your job, but he's got you covered. And it's our job not to judge, but to cover. Because we don't know what she might have gone through. We see her sitting here looking beautiful, smiling, but she's got a story. You've got a story. Nothing makes you special about being up here. You know what I'm saying? Anybody could do this. And there may come a day when God will use each one of you to share your story. And a lot of times we're ashamed to talk about the things that we've been through. It's time for some stuff to be exposed in the body of Christ. Because women are getting bitter, they're snapping, and they're losing their minds. People, not just women, are losing their minds even in the church because of the stuff that we go through, and we don't have a safe place to talk about it. You can't talk about it in your family because it's taboo. We've got to get back to loving. We've got to, y'all. This is so serious, because if we don't change, if we don't start loving our brothers and our sisters, then how is the world going to come in? How in the world is the world going to come in? We're supposed to be peculiar and set apart. But what makes us different than them? Because when they look at us sometimes, all they see is the bickering, the arguing, the judgment, the hypocrisy, and that gives them an excuse and a way out from coming to church. And Bunny can be a witness, and I'm calling on you a lot, because the Lord, I didn't even know she was going to be here to be my armor bearer. We went through so much at our old church. Some painful stuff that she and I talked about on the way here. Both of us have been without a pastor for the last 3 years because our pastor died, and he wrote the vision, and he made it plain. Our pastor was a very, very loving and giving man. Elder Maxwell can attest to that. He's a product of Elder Smith and Sister Smith. We built a million-dollar edifice that now sits empty because Haman came in. And we have a whole congregation of at least 400 people that have been without a church home in the city of Asheville because of Haman. That's why I'm stressing the seriousness of covering people. Our pastor needed to be covered. He had a few people that covered him. We were amongst those that covered him. But the main people that were in his circle that the king thought was his friend destroyed him. Caused him heartbreak. And he withered up and he died. I recently found a church home. And I am so thankful because I never thought I could call anyone else pastor. But I now have a new church home, and they were not from Asheville. They moved into the city. And I thank God for where I am now, because I'm growing. Even out of the pain of losing our pastor, losing our first lady, we suffered, y'all. But we're still here. We could have been dead and gone too. But God chose us to be here and plant the seeds that were planted in us from Elder Smith and Sister Smith. We all have potential. Seeds have potential. And you will never know that until you're in the right environment with the right people to cover you and with the Lord. We really, 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 really have to get serious. We have to stop being stagnant. We have to stop holding on to these positions that we think are ours because this is where we've been so long. We've got to train up our young ladies, our young men to take the reins, to pass the baton, because that's what Mordecai did. Mordecai passed the baton right on to Esther so that she was able to save her people. But she was rewarded in the process. So we have to stop making excuses and giving God all the reasons why we can't do something. If he said you can, you can. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. And it's not about us anyway. It's about him. It's about pleasing him. And when I think about Esther, and I'll be closing in just a few minutes, Esther went through 12 months of purification. The perfume that she used, the deodorant that she used, the garments that she was attired with, that was symbolic of the anointing of God. Before we can get into God's presence, we do have to come a certain way. If we're going to make a request of him, we've got to get humble and we've got to be covered. Yes, the veil was rent. Yes, it was ripped when Jesus came. But does that mean we just walk in anyway? No, it does not. We need the anointing back. We need restoration. We need healing. So if you're feeling discouraged or you're feeling like you're in a dry place, God has set this conference to pull you out and to encourage you and to let you know that you can run on. And if you feel like the knot is slipping, reach up and tie a new one. Grab hold. Because he's not going to let you fall. He's not going to let you fail. God is a good God. And if we can go to our earthly fathers and ask and make requests, why do we feel like we can't go to God? If it's according to his will, he's going to answer it. But if it's not, you won't get the request answered. But just know that this has been on my heart for some time to be able to just share my own Esther story. And I look forward to coming back next year and hearing some of y'all's Esther story, because I know there are some awesome stories in this room. God is preparing you for that next level. So get ready and get excited about what he's doing. We don't have to walk around sad. We don't have to walk around crying all the time. But get excited. Be joyful and be happy. And also rejoice when someone else is being elevated. Don't tear them down, but rejoice with them, because it's in your rejoicing that you will be blessed and elevated as well. So in closing, I do want to close with prayer, because usually after I speak, that's what I do. It's closing the word of prayer. And those of you who can stand, stand. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we come boldly before the holy throne of grace. Lord, we thank you for this is the day that you have made. We rejoice, Lord, and we are glad in it. We thank you, Lord, that this is another day that you've kept us alive. We thank you that when we woke up this morning, Lord, you breathed the very breath of life into our nostrils. We thank you, Lord, for bringing us to this sacred place to hear a word from you. We thank you, Lord, that after hearing what you have to say into your church, that we will never be the same again. But the words that have been spoken today will impact us, Lord, for the rest of our lifetime. That a change has taken place. We thank you, Lord, for being so good. And we thank you, Lord, for loving us when we were yet unlovely. We thank you, Lord, for looking past our faults and meeting every last one of our needs. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to serve you. We thank you, Lord, that you have planted good seed in us and that we can make a demand on that same seed. We thank you, Lord, for the women that came out today to be a part of this conference, that they will be blessed abundantly. We thank you, Lord, for Elder Maxwell and his wife, and we ask that you bless them, bless them, bless them a hundredfold for the work that they're doing here in this portion of the vineyard. And now, Lord, we thank you for one another. We may not know each other name by name, but we thank you, Lord, for our sisters in Christ. And, Lord, I ask that you bless each woman here and each young lady here under the sound of my voice. God, you said that we shall live and not die. And I thank you that that seed will not be aborted, that it will grow and that it will flourish in you in the name of Jesus. Lord, we love you. And we ask that you help us to realize your love for us. And help us to see ourselves like you see us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we thank you and we give thanks in everything. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Thank you.
I hope you enjoyed today's service. We here at Love Fellowship Believers would love for you to come out and fellowship with us. We're located again on 200 North Memphis Road on the beautiful campus of North Carolina A&T State University. Remember, God loves you, and so do I.